lot of the history and humanities teachers would have a concern that how do you really look at this climate and how does it fit into your normal teaching of history. As I said before, we are kind of used to having monumental as the only focus of our history, but it has to really shift to tribal, to folk, to traditional as well, for the kind of knowledge systems that are there. Now, this knowledge could be in terms of technology, in terms of material usage, and most importantly, in terms of the response to local climatic constraints that you see resolved, responded to the architecture of the folk people. So one is not really talk about a chronological history of chronological unraveling of history through our syllabus, but really focus on maybe something that is more thematic. So if you look at themes of energy, themes of sun, wind, light, themes of material usage, climatic comfort, and so on. So if they become central to teaching of history, who's there to stop us? So nobody is saying that you have to teach history in a particular way. So maybe especially history of the Indian subcontinent, we need to make energy as a central narrative. Energy, sustainability, uses of resources, how do you sort of be within the limit, so to say, and so on. So what does history teach us about this? So if those lessons are kind of brought forward in front of the students, they are more capable of appreciating old architecture. It doesn't remain in the dusty books, but becomes part of their everyday rhetoric also, hopefully. Second thing is having design exercises built into the teaching of humanities and history as well. For example, can I take a design of a jali pattern in my history lecture? So you look at Mughal jalis, you look at Rajasthani examples, you look at Indian temples in the southern parts of the country, look at the kind of immense variety that they have, and then can they really come up with something that is their own? So you are looking at aesthetics, you are looking at basic design, geometry, pattern making, as well as understanding principles of climate control. So that could become one point where all the various skills that go into making a designer can really come together as a design output. One could think of a lot of such design activities. For example, I had taken a group of students and where we measured the surface temperatures of various walls. So a typical temple which has a wall which is 5, 6, 7 feet thick, or you take the temperatures inside, outside on a hot summer day, and the differences are immediately apparent. So you don't really have to talk much. You just have to explain why this difference is there. So for example, in our case, while the outside walls were at around 50 degrees, the interiors were around 22 degrees. So just the mass and the kind of difference it makes to the climatic comfort to the occupant of the interiors. So experience is extremely helpful in making sure that the lessons are driven home. So rather than looking at theory of mass and how a mass of the wall is going to help in kind of controlling the temperatures, looking at actual readings makes a lot of sense. And then experiencing that cool or coolness in the inside and the hot environment outside. So it's a much better way of integrating your experience, your readings, which are coming from instruments, and the knowledge which explains this kind of phenomenon. So if all three are coming together, then the learning becomes much more permanent.